all of you. My name is CoramDeo. Welcome to our Tuesday night, evening, afternoon, whatever it is for you. It is that time for our Bible study, and I am glad that you are here. We have been studying through the book of Colossians. We are currently in the last chapter, and it is a delight that you are here tonight. As for our introduction, we're going to be talking about praying for the others, praying for Christians, praying for non-Christians. Is also a way to manifest our love for them, as true love for Paul would motivate the Colossians to intercede for him, for the apostle. John Calvin says that it is not in vain that the Lord has appointed this exercise of love between us, that we pray for one another. Amen. And our format tonight is worship, prayer, study, comments, and questions. I will post a song, and this is an oldie. Some of you will recognize Keith Green, and you will need to click in your browser. This will not play in the room. So let's watch the video. And when you are done, please type done into the room and we will continue.
In AAR.
These are the 9-inch Guggenheim Professional Tailor Shears.
But I.
Make my life a prayer to you. I wanna do what you want me to. No empty words and no white lies. No token prayers, no compromise. I wanna shine the light you gave through your Son. You sent to save us from ourselves and our despair. It comforts me to know you're really there. Oh, I want to thank you now for being patient with me. Oh, it's so hard to see when my eyes are on me. I guess I'll have to trust and just believe what you. Coming to take me away. I wanna die and let you give your life to me so I might live and share the hope you gave to me, the love that set me free. I wanna tell fairy tale that I have made up inside my head. Your God, the Son, you've risen from the dead. Oh, I want to thank you now for being patient with me. Oh, it's so hard to see when my eyes.
Have you heard of this brand new product that instantly cleans toilets without any...
Okay, I was just laughing to myself. I'm going to be bold and ask a question. Give me a thumbs up if you remember a group called the Second Chapter of Acts. Anybody remember them? If you answer yes, you're kind of dating yourself. I was thinking as we listened to that song by Keith Green. I went to a concert where the Second Chapter of Acts was singing, and they sang that song. That tells you how long ago that was. But such a wonderful, wonderful song that we, to make us a prayer for God, that we would be a prayer for Him. Amen? Well, let us pray. Father in heaven, we do thank you for the opportunity, the very privilege, the unique privilege to come before you in humbleness and call you Father, that we can come to you as a loving, gracious, heavenly Father with our requests, that we can pray to you, that we can seek you, that we can make requests to you. And Father, we are learning to trust in whatever answer you bring our way whenever we pray. We give you glory. We give you praise. Teach us to pray. And we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're coming to the end of Colossians, and just these three short verses in Colossians chapter 4 say this: continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear which is how I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Now, we read in the book of James that Elijah was a man with a nature exactly like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. Now, you might wonder, why am I talking about Elijah in this lesson? Well, you guessed it. It is because we are learning about the speech of the new man, the regenerate man. One way our speech changes is that if we are born again, or when we are born again, if we are sincerely seeking the Lord, then a natural byproduct of this will be that we will begin to pray. See, prayer doesn't change things. Prayer changes you. Show me a Christian that does not spend time in prayer, and I will show you someone who lives not only in defeat, but is not mature in the Lord. Listen to the words of R.A. Torrey. He says this: when the devil sees a man or woman who really believes in prayer, who knows how to pray, and who really does pray, and above all, when he sees a whole church on its face before God in prayer, he trembles as much as he ever did, for he knows that his day in that church or community is at an end. There's a unique connection between our private prayer lives and our public witness to the world. So my aim tonight, today, is to give some practical help from our text on how to pray more faithfully and how to bear witness more effectively. Because the connection between these two areas is that a private life of prayer is the foundation for a public life of effective witness. You notice in this book in Colossians, and I love that, thank you, Psalmist, no man is greater than his prayer life, by Leonard Ravenhill. Beautiful expression of truth. But you notice in these verses the connection between prayer and evangelism. There is no effective evangelism without prayer. Fervent, effective prayer. So Paul's main point is this: in private, devote yourself to prayer. In public, be a godly witness for Jesus Christ. So we'll break those two down into two different points. We'll start with the first. In private, devote yourself to prayer. Notice he says in verses 2-4, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make clear how I ought to speak. So notice here, he uses three terms here: steadfast, be watchful, be thankful. Steadfast, be watchful, be thankful. Now you notice how he talks about devoting ourselves to prayer. This goes throughout the New Testament. Let's look at some times where the apostles devoted themselves to prayer. And what was the result of that? Acts 1:14, right before the day of Pentecost. This is the apostles meeting together after Christ had ascended. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. Acts 2:42, the day of Pentecost, thousands are saved. And it says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Acts 6:4, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. Romans 12:12, rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, be constant in prayer. Ephesians 6:18, talking about the armor of the Spirit, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for the saints. That Greek word verb there, steadfast, is the word devote yourself, and it's often used in connection with prayer. You notice all of these that's talked about devoting themselves to prayer. We are admonished to pray without ceasing. Now, without ceasing does not mean we are praying nonstop every minute of the day, which would rather be impossible. We'd never get anything done. Rather, what it means is coming back to prayer again and again. It was used in the sense, think of a nagging cough. You've had a nagging cough, it seems like you never, ever get over it. That's what it is. It's always being on the cusp of prayer, always having that prayer on your tongue, ready to speak it out. be constant, be thankful, be conscious that God, Jesus, is with you. He is in you, and you are in him. So we can be constant in prayer. Now, Jesus taught persistent prayer in two, I believe these are rather humorous parables. The first one is found in Luke 11, where a man and his family are in bed at midnight when his friend starts banging on the door, asking to borrow some bread for a visiting guest. The guy in bed tells him to go away, and the guy just won't quit knocking. So finally, he gives up. He gives him what he's asking for. Now, in the second parable, which is found in Luke 18, a widow constantly annoys an unjust judge, an unwilling judge, to give her legal protection from her opponents. And at first he resists, but finally, because of her knocking, her persistence, he relents and grants her request. Now, the point of both parables is not that God is unwilling or that he is unconcerned about our needs, but rather that we should persist in asking until he grants our request. Persistent constancy in prayer. But then he mentions be watchful. Now, being watchful is often used in the context of mentioning our adversary, the devil, after urging us to cast all of our anxieties on the Lord because he cares for us. Paul exhorts, be of sober spirit. Be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Jesus tells us to be on the alert regarding his second coming. And in the garden, just before his arrest, he told his disciples, keep watching, keep praying that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. But there's a third word that Paul uses in these verses. Pray with thanksgiving. To pray thankfully is to pray in faith, especially when our circumstances often do not seem to be in our favor. Perhaps you've lost a job, or you've got a pile of bills due and not enough money to pay them. Maybe your teenager is rebelling and running with the wrong crowd, or your doctor has just diagnosed you with a serious illness. Whatever the overwhelming trial, it takes faith to pray, Lord, thank you in the midst of this trial, because I know that it's not too difficult for you. You will use it to strengthen my faith. So I ask you to answer for your glory, for your name's sake. So we pray persistently or steadfastly, watchfully, thankfully. The next question you might ask, well, what do I pray for? There seems to be an overwhelming amount of things to pray for. Where do I start? Well, pray for God's kingdom to expand through the spread of his gospel. Jesus taught his disciples, pray this way, let your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's what we pray, for God's glory, for his kingdom to expand, for the spread of the gospel. Prayer always seeks the glory of God. Prayer should always be directed toward the end goal, that all of the earth may know that he is Lord. We read that in the Old Testament. The Old Testament saints would pray, and then they would end their prayers and say, Father, so that the earth may know that you are Lord. Prayer is not necessarily for our refreshment or ease of life. We come to prayer with our supplications, but we also come to God in prayer for his glory to be reflected throughout the earth and for his kingdom to be manifested in the midst of an evil culture and generation. What we pray for is extremely important. When we pray, we ought to trust that God, like a loving father, is much wiser than we are, and that in the end, he does what he knows is best. There is mystery here, and we can well understand that we don't know all the ways of the Lord. What do we pray? Who do we pray for? We pray for co-workers, friends, neighbors, brothers and sisters in Christ, family members. There's no end to those for whom we might pray. Pray for open doors for the gospel. Even someone as gifted as Paul could not open his own doors for the gospel. He didn't rely on clever methods of salesmanship techniques to get an opening. Rather, he relied on God to open the doors. God must open the door for witness, but then we need to willingly walk through it. When God opens the door and we share the gospel, it is powerful to save souls and transform hearts through the power of the Spirit. So pray for yourself, pray for others in the church, that God would open the doors for the gospel. Pray for clarity in presenting the gospel. Paul refers to it as the mystery of Christ, for which I have been imprisoned. He does not mean that the gospel is mysterious or difficult to understand. Rather, mystery refers to a truth that was previously unknown, but now has been revealed. It can never be known by human wisdom, but only by God's Spirit. It especially referred to the truth that salvation, which had previously been revealed only to the Jews, was now available to the Gentiles, who now can enjoy right standing and equal access to God through faith in Christ. It is faith alone. And remember, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Amen. And it's divine sovereignty. I like that by Charles Spurgeon. There is no attribute of God more comforting to his children than the doctrine of divine sovereignty. I love that. Under the most adverse circumstances, in the most severe troubles, they believe that sovereignty has ordained their afflictions, that sovereignty overrules them, and sovereignty will sanctify them. It is God working his will in us for his glory. So praying for God's kingdom to expand through the gospel does not mean that we cannot pray for personal needs. Jesus instructed us, pray for our daily bread, pray for forgiveness for our sins, pray for personal holiness. But before we bring these needs to God in prayer, always remember, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So I encourage you, pray steadfastly, pray watchfully, pray thankfully for Christian workers, for open doors for the gospel, for the clarity in presenting the gospel. Private prayer is the foundation for public witness. To put it another way, talk to God about people before you talk to people about God. Then talk to people. Amen. We speak to God first, and then we speak to people and allow him to work through you through the power of the Spirit. I love that. Thank you, Shalom. Second point, in public, be a godly witness for Jesus Christ. He says, verse 4, walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Think of it. Our time is short. look what, remember what Paul said in Colossians 1, and I've emphasized some words here for you. And so from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk. Notice that wisdom precedes our walk. God gives us the wisdom. He gives us the understanding. He gives us the desires. And then he teaches us how to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you. It is a work of God, right? He qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in lightness. Notice the emphasis on the words wisdom and walk. Our walk of obedience to Christ flows from the wisdom he has instilled within us through the word and through the spirit. This is a deep and thorough knowledge of the will of God that is finally and completely revealed in the Word of God. Wisdom might be defined as the ability to accumulate and organize principles from Scripture. Understanding would be the application of those principles to daily living or our daily walk. Now, to walk with wisdom toward outsiders means that we are to live in line with God's word so that those who are not believers will see the beauty of Christ in our lives, in our relationships, in our words that we speak, in the actions of our heart. That gives us a platform to tell them the good news that changed our lives. A godly walk is the foundation for effective witness. Part of the godly walk is making the best of the time. When God opens the door, walk through it. The Greek word means to buy up or to grab the opportunity. In John 4, there's a contrast between Jesus and the disciples with regard to the woman at the well. Jesus saw her as a lost soul who needed the living water that he alone could give her. He had a harvest mindset because he saw that the fields were white unto harvest. But the disciples were focused on getting Jesus to eat his lunch so they could get on with their journey. So Jesus made the most of the opportunity, which the disciples totally missed. The foundation for making the most or the best of our time for witness is private, personal prayer for God to open the doors for the words. Pray for God to give you the gospel opportunities with people you come into contact with frequently. The second he opens the door, you're ready to go through it. You're ready to go through it. Winsome words are the means for effective witness. That was when we were doing apologetics with my seniors in high school. This was a word, winsome, that they had not really used before in their vocabulary and really didn't understand. It just means pleasant words, kind words. And I heard one person say, use winsome words to win some. I love that. Use winsome words, pleasant, pleasing words to win some. Remember, the gospel is offensive enough because we have to talk about sin. We have to talk about the reality that we are sinners headed for hell. So let our speech be pleasant. Let your speech always be gracious. This is verse 6. Seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. We need to be gracious in our speech, in our everyday conversation, particularly with outsiders. Our presentation of the gospel should be permeated with God's grace. Yes, we talk about sin. We talk about the reality of heaven and hell. But we must also explain God's unlimited, unmerited grace. The message that he gives salvation as a free gift to sinners who deserve his judgment. Since most people think that we earn salvation by our good works, it's really important to make sure that they understand that salvation is by grace alone, apart from any works. But also letting your speech always be with grace includes speaking graciously to others. As a sinner who has received grace yourself, we don't speak in a condescending or a condemning manner to another sinner. We must be kind and humble, letting the other person know that we are sinners too, who would be on the way to hell were it not for God's grace. So sharing the gospel is like one beggar telling another beggar where they can find bread. But Paul also mentions, notice, that our speech should be seasoned with salt. Now, salt had two main uses in Paul's day. It was used as a preservative from spoilage, which implies that our speech should be pure and free from corruption, and it should show those whose lives spoiled due to sin how they can be restored through the gospel. But salt was also used as a spice. It makes your food tastier. Our presentation of the gospel should stimulate people's taste to want more. Learn some helpful illustrations to help explain the gospel, to make it enticing, to make it interesting, to make it tasty. But also be sensitive. Paul says that you must know how to answer each person. People are different in their lifestyles. They're different in their backgrounds. So there's a different way to approach each person. This is where you must be careful about using a dry, memorized presentation of the gospel. Such presentations are very helpful to give you a general plan, but you need to adapt it to each person. One person may need to understand sin and judgment, but the next person may need to hear about God's abundant grace for sinners who repent. Look through the scriptures, look through the gospels, study the way that Jesus witnessed the encounters that he had in his life. He never used the same approach twice. He dealt with each person individually. He confronted the proud Pharisees, but was gentle with those who knew they were guilty, yet still dealt with their sin. So pray for wisdom as you speak, so that you will know how to respond to each person's unique needs. Yes, Paul did use a sense of apologetics on Mars Hill. If you read to that chapter, he pointed to their unknown God and then brought that out as their background. So I hope this has been helpful to see you how prayer connects to ministry. Prayer connects to evangelism. Just a couple of conclusions. First conclusion is this: let us learn to live a missions driven life, always looking. A missions-driven life is a life that is always seeking to draw the lost to God and to bring glory to God in the process. Paul, as he closes out this letter, exhorts Christians to missions. He calls them to partner in his mission and to be wise in ministering to those outside, those who are lost. Many times we think of missions as leaving home to do ministry, but actually, missions are all around us. In a sense, a mission-driven life flows from a heart attitude that should always be present within us, whether you work in education, business, teaching, or whether you're full-time ministry, whether you're a stay-at-home person, or even at church. It's a heart attitude that sees everything and everyone around them as a valuable part of God's mission to build his kingdom. Paul exhorts his church to live a life in view of those who are outside, living without hope, without God, without Christ. But second, ask God to give you a burden for the lost. Remember that those who are outside Christ, alienated from him, hostile in mind, just as all of us once were. Remember what it was like. That means we must be devoted in prayer for the lost around us. Learn to develop strategic partnerships with your church, with parachurch ministries, or even partnering with our four gospel server right here is a good place to start. You can minister to people who come in. Now, most of the people who come in are believers, but there are people that are hurting, that need prayer, that need support, that need uplifting and encouragement. So learn to be committed to living a wise life with a view towards the lost, towards the hurting, towards the downtrodden. So my encouragement to you is this: let us all be challenged to live lives in this hostile and evil generation that reflect the glory of Christ. Be purposeful, be intentional to live for his glory alone. May Jesus be praised and glorified in us. Yes, people are watching. We all have those circles, those spheres of influences. You knew there were cameras in your home. With all, there are cameras in my home. But anyway, so I hope this has been helpful to connect you with praying and evangelism and how it all connects together. We must be fervent in prayer. Amen. I'm going to play you a song to close us out. This is one that we sing often at church. This is one by the Gettys called In Christ Alone. My hope is found. And I love verse 3. I get excited when we sing verse 3. There in the crown his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he arose. Amen. And it closes with the words, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. So I will play. Yes, verse 3 is wonderful. And I will play this for you, and then I will close us in prayer. They're all good. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. That's sovereignty. Amen. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand. So, Father, we do thank you that you have elected us, that you have called us into freedom, that you are preserving us, that you are keeping us, that you are holding us until that final day, because we are your beloved sons and daughters, and we will stand firmly in the grace and the mercy of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We ask you to teach us to pray, and to pray constantly, to pray fervently. Teach us to pray rightly, that we might see your glory cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. So we ask, Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for the privilege of being here. We will be in the end of Colossians next week, so be back for the finale. May God bless the remainder of your day. Amen.